I also use the tape speed control to create nice soundscapes. To learn more, visit soundcollective.com.
What's up, guys? It's Nog. I'm here at Sound Collective for our industry mixer. This event is for all local DJs, artists, producers, and nightlife professionals to come and network with each other. Here at Sound Collective, we're going to be able to use a bunch of different production stations, booths, CDJs, and so many toys that are every audio producer's dream. This is the first of many events we're going to have at this venue with all these great artists and talent together, and you're going to have a chance to have all your tracks listened to and get some feedback as well, so stay tuned for more.
Hello and welcome to the Collective Masters Live class. I'm Vinny Pagano. I'm gonna teach you guys today some of the things that I've learned through some of my recording sessions. Right now we're running 11 different microphones, 11 cables, 11 inputs. Things can start to get pretty complicated. Just make sure that everything is coming in at a healthy level, but not clipping. We're just gonna do a couple of takes of this and then we'll get on to the mixing. All right, our time's clipped again, so we'll do one more take, please. May I have you go again? What I really want to try to do is add a little bit of reverb to this. It's going to just give a little bit more splash to your snares. If you want to get into some more drum mixing and recording, come on down to the Collective. Thanks a lot.
Peace, everyone. My name is Devon Drummer. I've been producing a little over 30 years. I've done tracks for the likes of Elder Sensei, Sadat X, Bumpy Knuckles, Georgia Ann Muldrow, Scatter RP, and Naps and Dreads, and a slew of others, man. I'm down at the Sound Collective today to show you about the beast of an app called Koala. This app is so fire. I promise you, you'll be making beats like no other. Once you check out my easy tutorials I have set, you'll learn how to import samples. You'll learn how to add effects to samples, filter samples. Hell, you're gonna even be able to make a bass line if you follow those steps. I promise you, this is so easy. Let's not waste no more time. Let's get into it.
So for the DJ intensive, I went down and got really nitty gritty into the details on how to get a DJ gig from a complete beginner.
In Manhattan, as I realized, there's no place to play drums. And so originally I was looking for a spot to just play drums. And I came upon this place through a Google search and kind of started scrolling through and seeing everything that is available here. And I'm not a DJ, or at least I wasn't a DJ, but I've always been curious about it. So I came in and I talked to the guys and they put me into this DJ intensive, and 2 weeks into it, I'm getting pretty comfortable doing it.
We'll be teaching the art of mixing, which is transitions, going from one song to the next, holding some of those transitions, which can also be looked at as a mashup or a blend, remixing, and some basic DJing skills like cuts, scratches, and the idea of playing what you like and also catering to the crowd and find that happy balance between introducing people to new music and also giving them a little bit of what they enjoy and finding a creative way to do that.
Through my techniques, I can teach you how to create the music and then get it to the right record labels. I usually do DJ instructions, how to use Pioneer turntables, music production using Ableton or Logic, and I'll show you exactly how you can create something from nothing and make it a big banger.
A big part of this program is learning about the music industry and how to promote yourself and, you know, what it takes to do music production, which is also part of this DJ class, what it takes to get your name out there, what it takes to, you know, contact record companies or distribution companies, you know, a whole lot of the business stuff that I also had never really thought about. So let's see where it goes.
My teaching style is kind of like the Bruce Lee Be Like Water. It's like the style of no style, whatever fits at the time. So if I see somebody needs a little bit more encouragement, I'll be a little bit more suggestive, or, you know, maybe you could do this. You know, sometimes people get stuck and get caught in their head.
It would take me forever to buy equipment and get it set up and, you know, try to figure it out on my own or through YouTube videos or things like that. But being able to come in here and all this equipment just available and guys here to just very patiently walk me through it, it was a crash course. I learned more in this 2 weeks than I could have learned in a year easily.
And then not only do I like to just teach, I kind of like to connect afterwards and make sure that you're still on the right path. Because at the end of the day, you don't want to just take this course and kind of feel like you're left with nowhere or no type of guidance. I can be that type of guidance for you.
I'm going to take that knowledge and kind of sit down and diligently work through, you know, what I want to do. But ultimately, I want to get some songs out. I want to play out and just kind of see where it goes.
Hey, what's up, y'all? It's me, Ski Beats at Sound Collective. Welcome to the dojo. Well, for those who don't know me, I'm a hip-hop producer. Did some cool records with some cool artists, Jay-Z, Camp Low. Man, look, the list goes on. Basically, the dojo is a community-based type of thing, man, because it's all about, you know, everybody lifting each other up. And, you know, they say, steel sharpens steel, so bring your swords to the dojo. The first thing I'm gonna do off bat is give you a sample, give you 30 minutes, see if you can flip it. That way I can test your skill level. We're gonna get into composing, how to arrange your music, how to sequence your beats. This, it's all different types of techniques, man, when it comes to production. You can do anything, bruh. It's the dojo. It's where we turn students into senseis.
Welcome to the Sound Collective. Our 28 Broadway facility is fully equipped to provide you with the tools of today's top industry professionals. Are you a DJ looking to practice for your next gig? A drummer who needs a place to practice your rudiments? Looking to host live performances, group events, practice sessions, or more? Need a place to record your next project? Unlock your ability to use all of these amenities and more with the Sound Collective membership. Send us a message to learn more.
Hey, what's up? I'm Lefty.
And I'm Rich Furness, and welcome to Groove City.
Raps don't slap no more like that.
Lefty and I are both DJs and producers here in New York City. We also work here at the Sound Collective, and we run a record label called Quincy Boy Records with our boy N2N.
Yes, and we couldn't be more excited to bring this new podcast to you, where we bring DJ culture to the forefront, interviewing producers and DJs, telling their backstory, followed by a 30-minute DJ set. So we hope you enjoy it, and thanks so much for watching.
Much love.
Hi, everybody. My name is Jacinta Clusellas, and this is Introduction to Finale. I am a composer, arranger, and guitarist from Buenos Aires, Argentina, and I have been based in New York for the past 6 years. I am a teaching artist at the New York Philharmonic, and I work as a composer, arranger, and guitarist with multiple projects in the city as well as internationally. In this course, we'll be diving into score setup and layout, different options for note input, getting familiar with tools such as articulations, dynamics, filter tools, and using shortcuts. By the end of this course, you should feel very comfortable with Finale, navigating the software and creating your own music. And you should be ready to export your music in order to share it with producers, recording artists, and musicians. Welcome, and let's dive in.
One cool thing to remember about the pocket operator when they're synced up all together is to make sure you set the volume for all of them. So I'm gonna go over here and press play on all the pocket operators. So the speak is gonna be the main volume out. So let's say I wanna turn down this. It's also gonna turn down the KO since it's connected to that one. So just make sure that all the sounds are set to a good amount, to a good volume. To learn more, go to soundcollective.com.
Hi, I'm John. I produce music under the name Proper Villains, and I'm teaching a course on how to program percussive sounds in Extra Serum. I'm gonna show you a quick lesson right now on how to make a TR-808 clap in Serum. Turn your level all the way down, then we're gonna assign LFO 1 to the level, we're gonna switch it to envelope, and we're gonna turn off the BPM sync. Drag this to the left, and now we have a very basic noise pulse. So a clap's just sort of like a little pulse of white noise with teeth. So we're just gonna go right in and draw the teeth. Turn on the distortion. We'll pick up our hard clip and just crank that baby. Bring the mix down a little bit. And there you go, a TR-808 clap in Serum. If you like what you've heard and I piqued your interest, check me out on soundcollective.com.
I want to welcome everybody to the Sound Collective. We are a collective for you guys to come and meet as a community. We have a bunch of really awesome events planned for the summer. If you guys want to just dive in, learn Ableton, Logic, learn an instrument like drums, keyboard, vocals, any of that stuff. We'd love to have you, and we're really excited to build with you guys as a community. No further ado, I will introduce my brother, an amazing producer. Lefty's going to go ahead and do a breakdown.
Thank you everybody for coming out here for this. So this was like a topper. Had some hats, some bongos, and claps. I did an EQ to cut out some of the sharpness of the hat because it was conflicting with the other loops that I had in there playing hi-hats. Does anybody have any questions? We got another one here. Follow Sound Collective on Instagram to keep up with our events. Thank you guys for hanging out.
Okay, let's complete this big buildup scenario by adding a few more elements to just get it to pop. Yes, there you have it, there you have it. We have our epic build-up breakdown scenario. Peace.
My name is Manuel Valera, and this is Modern Composition. I've been fortunate to travel the world playing my own compositions and collaborating with artists like Joshua Bell, Paquito de Rivera, Arturo Sandoval, and many others. I have also received a number of prestigious awards, such as the Guggenheim Fellowship in 2019. I won a Grammy as well, and I've been nominated multiple times in the past. In this course, we will cover fundamental composition concepts, ways to develop harmonic, melodic, and rhythmic ideas, composing using traditional methods as well as in a DAW, and how to prepare your compositions to be played by live musicians from a small ensemble to a philharmonic orchestra. These skills can help you in a variety of career paths, such as composing for film and TV, arranging for performing artists, as well as your own personal projects. Let's dive in.
This track, OSAA, long journey from demo to drop. My stock beat made on a laptop on tour. Bringing it to my buddy J-Criv, us deciding to produce something together, start adding elements, layering a lot of stuff, live instrumentation, working on the drums a bunch. Taking shape. The real icing on the cake, our buddy Sammy, a Cameroonian vocalist, adding his vocals. Then followed by the mixing and mastering process. So the final version. Cool, so that's a bit of this track's story from demo to drop. To learn more, visit soundcollective.com.
Want to thank Sisters in Sounds for hosting this event in conjunction with Sound Collective, and we just want to open the space to everyone.
People ask me all the time, Ariana, how do I get booked? How do I get booked? And
right. The
truth is just make and play good frickin' music.
Give space, take space, but don't make yourself small. Establish your boundaries and stand firm.
This is Smack Pack season one finale.
We back, baby.
This is the cream of the crop. The best of the best.
Who you got your money on? The Bond is on his boom bap heavy. Jewel's is like on some atmospheres, doing something totally different over there. Slings, emoji, melodic thing happening with the crazy switch ups. Overlord, you know, that bounce is ridiculous. This is why I love hip hop music, man. It's just so colorful, you know what I mean? This is it. This is the grand finale. It's going down.
Crunch time for real. 3, 2, 1.
Step away right from the machine. Von Drummer, let's see what you got, baby. Drum game crazy.
I think it's Divine Drummer, bro.
Divine Drummer. Congratulations, baby.
What's happening, Divine Drummer?
Welcome to the Sound Collective Professional Music Entrepreneurship Certificate Program. This program is your opportunity to earn a certificate in music entrepreneurship anywhere and anytime. To earn your certificate, you must complete learning paths in four required categories: performance, industry literacy, composition, and production. Within performance, you can choose from a selection of various instruments to begin mastering your skill.
And it's a variation moving your left hand around, whatever right.
So whenever we want to talk about leading mode, that's the
way to build our A rootless voicing, which is the first kind of voicing, is simply.
Industry literacy will take you on a journey through the music business.
It's a great way to make money if your touring is down, if you have.
And proper studio etiquette.
To the left, it's actually increasing the volume of that track on the left.
With composition, you'll get into the fundamentals of music theory.
Let's say that in a real life situation, we have a singer that cannot sing in a particular key.
And composition.
The B section we have so far.
And finally, production will see you choosing between DAWs to round off your knowledge. Of course, you don't have to take this journey alone. Our incredible network of mentors is available to you for one-on-one chats to keep you on pace and confident in your education. You may even recognize some faces from your video lessons. This is a program that is designed to prepare you to work in the modern music industry. By the end, you should be fully ready to top the charts, take the stage, and create your own ideal musical universe. Let's get started.
All right. I want to welcome everybody here to the Sound Collective. I am Ricky, the president for the school here. We are doing a series called Collective Masters Live, where we try to bring in a bunch of people to do different workshops and talks within the music industry. And today we are very excited to welcome Zach Abramson for our discussion. Thanks for being here.
My pleasure.
Hi, everybody. So for anybody who doesn't know you, do you want to give everybody a little bit of background?
Sure, yeah. My name is Zach. I am a composer and bass player, pianist here in New York City. I work at a audio production studio called YouTooCanWoo with some of my closest friends. Ooh. And we do a wide range of music and audio things. So in addition to video game music, we do music for film and TV, advertising, sonic branding. We have a record label.
That's amazing. A little bit of everything.
So, a little bit of everything, yeah. And so, you know, I participate in all those things with our company, but I find myself gravitating towards the world of video game music and have been over the last few years. So that's what I spend most of my time doing.
That's awesome. So I feel like video game composing isn't something that people normally think to jump into. Like you talk to a lot of producers who are in, you know, sync, TV, television, film. Yep. What kind of brought you into the video game music composition world? Were you a video gamer from the get-go?
That's a great question. Because you're absolutely right that nowadays it's different. But you know, years ago, the idea of video game composing as a career wasn't really something that was on the radar as much.
Yeah.
So my background was in classical composition. I went to school at Manhattan School of Music, which is a conservatory here uptown. And I did my undergrad and my master's there. And, you know, by the time I was finishing my master's, I was kind of feeling like, you know, concert music was an important part of my life.
Yeah.
And the skills that I had learned in school were an important set of skills that I still use every single day. But I knew that it wasn't checking all the boxes of all the things I wanted to do. So at the same time that I was in school, I was playing in like a ton of bands.
What kind of bands was it?
I was playing in... Well, in a ton of different types of bands, but I was playing, I'm a bass player, and I gravitated towards like dance bands and funk bands and stuff like that. So I was, playing, you know, music like that was in a lot of looping music, which will come up later as part of our video game discussions. Music that kind of loops and kind of spins itself out in real time. I was also working on narrative films and documentary films. I found myself in the musical theater world for a little bit.
Okay.
And I was in the studio with bands, you know, my friends who were my bandmates, some of them are incredible audio engineers, and I was learning just by watching them,
you know, work a tape machine or like how to use a compressor or all these things that we never learned in music conservatory,
yeah.
but were became a part of my background.
Did they have anything for like video game composing, video game music design when you were in school? Or is
no,
that...
they had a class that I regret taking. That
oh,
was
no.
on. That was, no, I'm sorry. That I regret not taking. Is what, I regret not taking. I regretted not taking this class that was on basically scoring a picture using a sequencer.
Okay.
So, and I had done, I had worked, when I was in high school, I had, you know, early MIDI sequencers, a program called Encore, which
oh,
is a computer program.
Oh, I remember Encore,
program.
Yeah.
So you could hook your keyboard up with MIDI cables and your Sound Blaster and do MIDI sequencing, but it didn't have any audio or anything like that.
Uh-huh.
So in school, yeah, there was an electronic music course and there was a music to picture course. And I took the electronic music course and it was fine and I enjoyed it, but it wasn't the most, you know, the electronic part of it wasn't about like using computers. It was about using like synthesizers and things, which was interesting in a different way.
Yeah, for sure.
So yeah, I was, you know, in the world of New York City doing all these different things and working all these different ways. And someone who I'd worked with in the film world, I didn't even know that he was in the video game world. And he asked me if I would be interested in writing demos for video games, you know, to be considered to be a composer on a video game. And this was 2012. So I graduated in 2005. So between 2005 and 2012, I was trying to do whatever I could
yeah.
just to learn more and try to figure things out.
Yeah, what path you wanted to take.
And then I did this demo in 2012 and all of a sudden everything just like clicked into place where it's like,
you're where you were supposed to be.
And all the skills that I had been developing, whether it's concert music, like writing for orchestra, or narrative, you know, writing for films, or non-linear music, writing, like being in a band and things like that, and production techniques that I've been learning, you know, from my friends and just from being in studios and things like that, all those things came together when I started doing these video game demos. And then, you know, it's like one of those things where you, when you see the thing that like is making you feel very like, you know, artistically fulfilled, you know, you
yeah.
try to pursue it. And so that's what I've been doing.
That's actually a good segue. So, you know, you came from doing more, I guess, traditional compositions. Mm-hmm. How does making video games differ from, you know, making something for an album or for a movie?
That's a good question. And it's the thing that I find most interesting about video game music is the fact that video game music is, generally speaking, non-linear or adaptive or reactive, meaning the music does not just go from beginning to end, generally speaking.
Mm-hmm.
And there's like many different levels of what that could mean. So you could have an entire world of music and each, wherever you go in the world of the game pulls up something from the world of the music that plays as part of the, like to represent the world itself. But then you could have smaller subsets of that where it's like, this section of this piece of music plays because this amount of enemies is on screen trying to get you.
Yeah.
Or this layer of music comes in because you've changed the speed of motion by a certain amount.
Yeah.
So like now all of a sudden the faster layer of music comes in. And that's all something that as a video game composer you need to be thinking about how all these different things can relate to each other and defining what I sometimes call the adaptive potential. So like, what is the range of player experience that the music needs to cover? And how do we accomplish that goal as a composer?
So what exactly is this adaptive process? Because I feel like that's something I'm not as familiar with.
Yeah, so you can think of it on a couple different levels. I think to me, the big picture adaptive stuff is like, what, you know, again, going back to the game itself and the player's experience, like what are you doing in the game, which you could call the game loop, I suppose. Like the idea of there's an input and then the player does something because of that input and there's an output back and forth.
Yeah.
So like on the simplest level, something like Tetris, right? There's
yeah.
like the game loop is a block falls. Everybody here play Tetris, I assume,
I hope
or knows
so.
A block falls and then you can rotate the block, right? That's sort of the game right there is you can rotate the block and then the block stops falling when it hits the bottom.
Mm-hmm.
But then there's a second game loop, which is that if you get a row, a horizontal row of blocks, then it disappears, which allows you to continue playing, because the biggest game loop is that when the blocks go from the bottom to the top, the game is over.
Yeah.
And then I suppose there's even a bigger one, which is that after the game is over, your screen is on a, or your score is on a high score screen, which gives you this compulsion, the compulsion loop, to play it again.
Yeah.
And to try to do better, or to try to beat your friend whose name is also on the high score screen or something like that. So where does music like fit in to all those different things?
Elements and pieces.
And how does that work? Yeah. So for I can talk about two of the games that I've worked on if you want me to get into
them. Yeah, let's dive into it.
I'll start with, that was my test sound. Now we're going to go to the right screen. Okay, so this is a game that I worked on a few years ago, which will be, it's in early access and will be out as a full launch sometime pretty soon. So Second Extinction is, I think it's fun to look at the artwork because you can get a sense of what the gameplay is just by the art, right? So it's pretty clear what's going on here. You are fighting evil, well, I hope they look evil, evil mutant dinosaurs.
This looks awesome.
Yeah.
I'd play this game.
The tagline is pretty good, yeah. You're trying to save the world from evil mutant dinosaurs. And it's a first-person shooter, which is a type of game where you are in the perspective of the actual character in the game shooting dinosaurs. So for a game like this, there is a pretty obvious game loop, a pretty obvious experience, which is that you start with this menu. Front end is the industry term, and then you know this is where you might customize your character or your loadout, the weapons you choose to use, find your friends if you're doing a multiplayer game. Then you go down to the surface of the planet, and that's like the combat part of the game. And then you complete objectives in your mission, and then you could die or fail, and go back to the front. Or you could complete your objectives and then try to be like go to an extraction point and get out off the planet's surface with all the stuff that you might have collected on your mission. And that, of course, is the hardest part of the game, and that's like the boss part, if you want to use like the industry term boss.
Yeah.
And and then when you get up to the top, you have all of your the stuff that you've collected, and you can use that to upgrade your gear, which will make it easier to play the next time around. So that's the big compulsion loop part of it, right? But so musically, how do you represent all these different things? How do you represent this menu screen? How do you represent the combat? How do you represent the intensity of that extraction moment and then all the transitions? And like, you know, what is the gradient of different musical experiences that you might need to do all that? For a game like Just Cause 4, which came out a few years ago, Just Cause 4 has a much more nuanced set of gameplay experiences that are happening. Right, it's called an open world game, which means that you can go anywhere in the game and do anything in any particular order for the most part with these narrative bottlenecks that will stop you from, you know, that you progress the story by getting through the bottlenecks. But for the most part, you can do whatever you want. And for a game like that, there's basically you are given a quest, and then you explore the world to find the place that you need to go to complete the objective of the quest, and then you enter into combat, and then that quest completion opens up more quests that you would be able to do. And that's a pretty standard game loop.
Can I ask a quick question?
Sure.
So I'm more familiar with film scoring, and when you think about film scoring, you're scoring to like the video, you know, behind you. With those two different game types, one that's kind of a little bit more open and one that's kind of a little bit more narrative, I guess.
Right.
Are you scoring to the video game? Like, are you building the music to those scenes, or how is that process kind of done?
So because the game is almost guaranteed to be not done when you are working on it, there's no way that the development process is such that, unlike a film, which is in post-production when the composer steps in, generally speaking. A video game could be in various different phases of production. And so, you know, you have to know where you are in the production and know what you can contribute when.
Yeah.
And hopefully they are at a point where they have one of every, you know, it's like the entire experience of the game is kind of known. And so you can compose at least one thing for
each
everything.
Part.
And then you can spread it out from there. But so though I will get from a developer like the artwork, a creative brief. Hopefully I can get a playthrough of parts of the game that I'm working on. Like it would, you know, usually there's a case that there's at least a playable section of the game that is the part that I'm trying to write music for.
Yeah.
But in order to get the entire experience, you have to use your imagination. Unlike a film where, yes, they're going to be in the edit. You know, no one is getting a locked edit on film these days anymore. You're getting a, you know, mostly locked edit, hopefully,
yeah,
that is telling the story. So you still have to use imagination, but it's different than a video game where you really have to think, okay, this music is the exploration part, this is the combat part.
Yeah.
I haven't been able to figure out how we're going to get from exploration to combat yet, but we're going to figure that out eventually and kind of like make those big decisions as best you can and then hone it in as best you can as you go.
Yeah. Does that make it harder for something like a Just Cause 4, like where it's more open world? You have to have like more material put together for something like that?
Yeah, you can. Well, I can play you some stuff if you want to hear it.
Yeah, let's hear it. Let's go through it.
I can play you some exploration music and some combat music, and we can talk about how they relate to each other. If that
awesome.
Makes sense. So let me actually. I don't know if my slides are in order here. Oh, they were. All right, so. I have some key art from Just Cause 4. This is one of the locations in the game. It's actually one of the first locations you go to, and you can tell that where it's like a bridge, but you can kind of tell people are sort of living under it. It's like a slum bridge, and it's this beautiful natural world. The game takes place in a fictional South American island. It's extremely beautiful place, but it's not perfect. You know, there's all these elements of decay and pollution and humans that are in tough spots in their lives. So we want to, when you're exploring this world, we want to feel, you know, the beauty of it, but we also want to feel that there's some imperfections to it. Mm-hmm. So we did a combination of using like almost like a found sound sampled approach for a lot of the instruments that were like maybe from this fictional culture.
Okay.
And then combine that with, and of course those are like South American inspired instruments from, mm-hmm. you know, this is not a true South American place. So we were able to kind of put together our own culture, combining some other ideas, and then combining that into like a larger cinematic experience. So like big width and a lot of reverbs and things like that. So this is some music that you would explore the world another fun thing about Just Cause, it's a fun game. Apparently it's on Game Pass right now. So if anybody wants to play Just Cause 4, this is a really good time to do it.
Great game.
So you can fly around this world with this pretty amazing but ridiculous parachute, wingsuit, grappling hook contraption. So
it's one of my favorite parts of the game.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of people will just kind of fly around for a while. So I'm glad you played it.
But. Yeah.
So this is some of the music that you'd hear if you were flying around the world.
As somebody who's played the game too, I put myself there when I hear the music. You almost put yourself into the game, and I actually as a test before we did this interview, I played a couple games where I muted the music because you know you have the slider to mute the music, and the game has so much less impact.
Yeah.
When you take that music out, and it's incredible to like think about it in that way.
I mean, it's one of the my favorite things about music for media, but especially for video games, because you could be playing this game for a really long time.
Really immersive.
And it's part of the full experience, like you said, an immersive experience, and you hear it a lot, and you start having these associations with like fun times playing a video game. And
absolutely.
I think everybody who plays games has a special place in their heart for a lot of the music, especially for older games, You know, trying to capture that feeling like when you're a kid and stuff like that, of like, oh yeah, like
this nostalgia.
And I think, you know, I love it when people leave the music on in games now. Yeah. A lot of people turn it off, and I totally get that, because you want to put on your own stuff, or you want to kind of chill out more, because mm-hmm. The music can make the game feel a lot more intense. Yeah. But it's always nice, I think, to play the game with the music on and have those like emotional experiences and things.
Absolutely. I mean, even with like horror games, like I was thinking about it, like looking at some of your notes before this, like the adaptive element, it'll add so much more tension and so much like terror to the game.
And the scariest thing in horror games is when there's no music.
Yes.
Because then it's like
something's coming.
Yeah, you know, whatever's going on, it's going to jump out of you at any moment, and you're not going to be prepared. So that's exploration. This is for combat. I have an image of this like super soldier guy with a laser weapon. So combat's very different, obviously. This is, you go to an objective and like you're fighting enemies. And so obviously this relaxing cinematic experience isn't necessarily what we want. So we're pushing for like a lot of, this character is kind of in this world of a 80s dystopian super soldier, kind of Terminator, Blade Runner kind of thing. So we were using a lot of like synthesizers that we have at the studio, and combining that with these like big cinematic, big orchestral moments, and using along with that the same kind of sounds of the world, but distorting them a lot. So like you're gonna hear in this one some of the same like kind of flute sounds and things like that, but they're pushed much harder. So okay. Here's some of, this is from one of the big campaign moments in the game.
Battle that boss right now.
In that one, you can hear like, you know, there's still the same like 12-8-6-4 like samba or Argentinian rhythm patterns in there, but now they're against the pulse, so it feels like much more syncopated and intense. And then there's those flute. I don't know if you could hear those flute things in the background, mm-hmm. but those are the same kind of style flute gestures that we heard in the exploration music, but now just like pushed much, much harder. So there's this gradient of the experience when you go from exploration to combat, where you're in a very different part of the game, but hopefully, even within the midst of all these different influences and these different experiences, there's still some sort of continuity, even through the whole open world game.
Yeah. Well, I think it's interesting when you talk about the continuity and going with the adaptiveness of the gameplay. How do you go about that? How do you transition from that whimsical, more like adventurous music to that? And like, what's the process for the adaptiveness in the music?
Sure, yeah. I can talk about it in terms of Second Extinction if you want me to do that.
Yeah.
Maybe we should move on to that one. Let me just play a little bit more music from Second Extinction to get a sense of it. And then I have a video of the entire game loop of Second Extinction that I could play for you.
Oh, I want to see that.
Yeah. Okay, so this is, remember when we first started talking about Second Extinction, we were talking about the menu part of the game. So the menu is where you are, there's no fighting, there's no tension, you are just selecting what you need to select to get your loadout together so that when you go down to the surface you can have as successful of a time as possible.
Yeah.
So what we wanted to do is get the player to going from a very calm state to get really amped up to get down to the surface. So what we started with was this kind of like chill on pulse. And then as the player selects more and more stuff and gets closer to the end, by the time they select their insertion point, the main theme of the game kind of comes in. So I did an edit of that so you could hear how that all works together. So this is the super chilled out, selecting my weapons. Battle. Okay, so let's say like pretend that's where you chose. Let's say here's where you chose your insertion point. Now it's gonna ramp up. By the time you get there, hopefully the player's like, oh, okay, let's
we're ready to go. Yeah.
And then you would drop down to the surface. And then once you get on the surface, the idea would be, okay, now we're fighting these evil mutant dinosaurs. And now my goal as a composer is to try to help the visual team and the combat team, everybody, to make the player feel as uncomfortable and like tense as possible.
Yeah.
So after all that hype. So we went with this sort of, we're calling that like a, I called that palette up on the ship like the salvaged orchestra. It's like you're the last of humanity and you have this like salvaged gear and like that's your orchestra sound. So if that's the sound of the ship, then on the surface it's like we're using this Stravinsky palette, like the Rite of Spring. I don't know if you know that piece, but it's like a part of the, from about 100 years ago, part of this like primitivism movement mm-hmm. in orchestral music that was then adopted by Disney in Fantasia. So the dinosaur segment of Fantasia is this piece. And for whatever reason, I think it's just part of like our unconsciousness that dinosaurs are related to this piece of music. If you listen to the Jurassic Park soundtrack, he's referencing Stravinsky all over it, you know,
oh, wow.
Along with his John Williams' usual Strauss and a lot of other references, but he's pushing it in this other direction for that. And I feel like it's in there in this kind of unconscious place. So for this hyper Stravinsky, we're kind of going in that direction, but adding a lot of synths and distorted woodwinds, distorted baritone sax, distorted bass clarinet, things like that. So this is what the combat music sounds like. Subs in here are great.
Yeah. So
we can, that's obviously really different, right?
Yeah.
So unlike Just Cause 4 where there's some continuity, this, we wanted to create a very different experience, but we still need continuity across this game loop. So just to go through it again, we have our title screen intro. We didn't see that, but believe me, it's a intro, epic intro. And then this is the music that we heard first, the sort of like choosing loadout stuff when you're in orbit. Then, I'm gonna show you this in a second, you get in this drop pod to go down to the surface. So right after you hear that anthem, you are gonna get in a drop pod and the music is gonna transition to the Stravinsky sounds. Then when you're on the surface, that's when we're hearing the stuff we just listened to. Let's say if you don't have a mission fail, death, and you complete your objectives, you can get to an extraction point and return to orbit. So that's gonna be the highest intensity. And then when you get back, we need some sort of transition to go from the intense Stravinsky palette back to the chill menu music.
Yeah.
So It's using those two extremes and then trying to find little places to fill it in so that it feels like an organic experience. So I have a video I can play now. The video is my brother, who's a much better video game
I figured you'd be gamer. A pro.
It's an unfortunate true fact is that my love of video games outweighs my ability to play them. But my brother happens to be really good, and he happens to live around the corner from me. So I asked my brother if he would be interested in making a video, and I was like, the caveat is because the guns in this game are really loud. It's like, I would need you to like engage a T-Rex, but you can't really shoot it.
I was like, sounds like a good challenge.
Like, if you're gonna shoot it, yeah. If you're gonna shoot it, I told him he has to use a shotgun because it doesn't have like a rapid fire, so you can still hear the music. So he did well. He got out of it, but you know, he would have done much better, I think, if I hadn't given him that caveat. So here, there'll be on the video. I won't say anything, but you can read like what type of music we're listening to. It's I wrote it out with the video. So here we go.
Thank you.
You can see how, right. Thanks. It's a fun game. That game is also available to play on Game Pass right now, I believe. So if you have Game Pass, you can play that one. It's really fun. But basically, what we talked about, you know, we have these two contrasting musical styles for the front end and the combat part of the game. And then these transition moments, like the drop pod moment, where we're bringing in different layers of music as the drop pod hit the ground. And then in the extraction moment, when it's like, okay, all hell is breaking loose in terms of the amount of dinosaurs that are currently here, and I need to get out of here, but I need to stay here for 40 seconds so the ship can land, you know, bringing in the orchestra there, the big orchestra that you know, were holding out on that during the rest of the combat sequence.
Yeah.
And then after you get in the ship, we lose all that intense Stravinsky stuff, and we're left with just the orchestra, which makes the transition back to the front end.
Yeah.
So thinking big picture about all that kind of stuff is super important and a big part and the fun part of writing music for video games, I would say. So.
And does it kind of come back to what you had said that you're doing a lot in university was like the looping? Mm-hmm. So it's like you have pieces of this loop and you're just kind of adding it as the intensity becomes higher.
Thinking non-linearly about the music you're writing, right?
Yeah.
So, and actually that drop pod moment was built, and I believe, off of tech that was designed for a waterfall boat jump in Just Cause 4, because it was a similar engine. And that waterfall boat jump there's a guy in the room right now that did that, and it seems like it's simple, but to get the music layers to loop and then the music layers to add up on top of each other.
Yeah.
Right as you hit the surface of the drop pod is actually not easy to do.
I can imagine, yeah.
There's like a huge amount of tech that's under the surface that Ronnie could speak to a lot better than me. But the idea behind it is you're basically using it's called an audio middleware, but it's essentially like a DAW, but it runs alongside the game engine to basically. Game engines themselves have audio functionality in them too, but these audio middleware programs give you a lot more power,
flexibility.
So they don't look like standard DAWs. This is WIZE, W-W-I-Z-E, WIZE, which is one of the two big ones. The other one being FMOD. You can see there's waveforms, and this is actually MIDI. You can run MIDI in these things, but other than that, it doesn't really look like a DAW.
Looks a little bit like Fruity Loops.
it's got the same like extremely dull gray color, but it's what's going on here is instead of the music being arranged linearly on a timeline, it's arranged here in this hierarchy. So this is like a hierarchy tree that has all the audio, and this program is extremely powerful, and we're just looking at a very small
part of it.
But so the audio is part of this hierarchy, and you as a technical sound designer or the composer yourself would come up with the system by which the game would sync up to WIZE and call out which audio is gonna play what, whether that be like these footsteps play on sand and these footsteps play on gravel and these footsteps play on mud, to like, I'm gonna call up each layer of this music as you get closer and closer to something, or you know, there's all these different ways you could get the game engine and the music audio middleware to line up. So it's really cool. It's really interesting. There's a ton of, like, I guess you could call that, instead of thinking about like adaptive musical styles like we've been talking about, that you could think of it as adaptive playback. So how is the music actually being played back technically in the audio engine to cover all the bases of all the stuff that you need the music to do? So
are you actually composing in that, or do you bring the music in once it's already composed?
It's pretty tough to compose in it. I use Logic, which, you know, I don't know.
Yeah.
But I have a love-hate relationship with Logic, and I spend most of my time hating it. But it's
anybody
it
who does, works in a DAW has the same.
It's the same, no matter which one you use, and there's no one is better than the other. But so I would generally compose in Logic and then export stuff, and then if a sound designer is working, I would deliver it to the sound designer at a developer, and they would maybe put the audio into the audio middleware, or sometimes the composer themselves would do it. Depends on the relationship between the composer and the company, how big the company is, the developer, that is,
yeah.
and the composer's skill set, because sometimes the composer isn't interested. A lot of composers will deliver just a ton of stems, like, and, you know, there might be a music editor on staff at the developer who might do the edits instead of the composer. But, I mean, I like working that way too, but I think it's really fun to kind of be in the sandbox and make the music, you know, design the music systems alongside the development team to make it work.
Gives you the full creativity too to build it, right?
And it's fun, yeah. It's just, it's a fun, different thing. So, So the three, so just in terms of that adaptive playback stuff, the three big things that you can do as a composer are loop the music. I think everybody here is familiar with video game music that loops, right? Not all video game music loops. If it's on a playlist, like if you're in a racing game or something like that, the music might, you might call it music from a random playlist.
Mm-hmm.
But most video game music underscore loops. And so you need to also define, okay, how, what are the loop points, and then how are you going to get out of the loop if you need to? So like if you're thinking about Mario Brothers or something, something simple, right? Well, when you, if you get hit or something and the music stops and there's a little stinger, a little tag at the end of it.
Yeah.
So you need to write that little stinger so that it could work essentially at any moment during
to go to the next
the loop. Yeah. Or when you go to the flagpole at the end of Mario, you know, and like that flagpole music plays or something like that, you know. So that's one thing. The other thing you can do is called, I guess in the industry term is vertical layering, but that's essentially mixing, kind of like mixing stems of the music as you go. So in Just Cause 4, for instance, we had a, during that flying system, we were listening to basically just a straight playback of the flying music. But if you switch, and if you play the game, you know, sometimes you're in the wingsuit mode and sometimes you're in the parachute mode. Well, when we were developing that music, we were thinking like, you know, this music works pretty well when you're in the wingsuit mode and you're moving kind of fast. But when you're floating there in parachute mode, the music feels like it's too fast. Okay, well, if I write one that feels like floaty and stuff like that, when we go into wingsuit mode, it doesn't feel like we're moving fast enough. So a very obvious solution, right, is we have a layer of music that comes in and out based on whether or not you're in wingsuit mode or parachute mode. So there's like a floaty layer that's always there for a parachute, and then there's a much faster rhythmic layer that kind of comes in and out as you switch between parachute and wingsuit. And from there, we kind of open the floodgates and like, okay, well, what if you get really close to the ground and we added like an even faster layer that, you know, when you're like close to something fast, like in the car, like if something's out the side window, it just seems like it's moving so much faster because you're close to it. So we added a third layer that's like only comes in when you become, when you get into proximity to the ground. And then we added moments when you go all the way up to the top of the, above the cloud layer and you drop through the clouds. We added these special loops and stingers like to emerge through the clouds and you see the world below you and stuff like that. I can show you, I have a video of some of these things playing if you want to see
it. Check it out.
So I think I got to skip one here. Skip one. Okay. So this is not, this is not Wise, this is, or FMod, this is Logic. Rather than, the audio middleware does not often give you like a graphic representation of what's going on. I thought it'd be easier to just show you in Logic. So the top, the first thing we're gonna hear is this loop of music that plays when you are above the clouds. Then when you drop through the clouds, you'll hear this like kind of like stinger and like hopefully the feeling is like, oh, this beautiful world is below me now. And then we go into the main looping of music and we're gonna start hearing both the wingsuit and cloud layer, but then I'm gonna start in the video, I'm gonna bring the wingsuit layer in and out so you can hear the differences. And then I'll bring in the ground layer, and then there's a layer for if you fly over an enemy base, there's like a low drone that comes in to kind of give you a foreboding sense if you get close to an enemy base as you're flying. So let's see what that sounds like. So this is the cloud. Just imagine you're kind of floating in this big cloud. You can't really see the ground. Okay, now you emerge through the bottom of the clouds. Okay, so we've heard this music before today. And so this is the standard, both layers, the wingsuit and the parachute. Actually hear this in the game, but just so you know what it sounds like. So if the player were to switch back and forth between the parachute and the wingsuit, they might hear something kind of like that. So yeah,
that's so cool. As somebody too has played that game, I've probably noticed it subconsciously, but not until you played that did I realize how many layers went into it. And I think people think about the attention to detail visually in games, but how powerful the sound can be in that.
And my goal, I mean, our goal on the audio team was that you wouldn't, as a player, be
aware.
I never
thought about it.
Yeah, like you don't. The player should feel like, oh, I'm floating now. It shouldn't be like, oh man, that layer of music just like, of course. If that's what's going through the player's head, then we've failed on one level, because it shouldn't be about that. It should be about what's going on in the game experience. So, you know, I'm always surprised when people notice it, because I'm like, oh, that's really cool. That means you must have played the game a lot.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's to me, this to me is just as fun as writing the music itself, is coming up with these systems, coming up along with our team of like how all these things work together. Because it's obviously, it's not just me, it's the developers. You know, identifying that this is this gameplay moment that we need to cover, and
yeah,
like, okay, how are we going to do this? So, you know, you're on a team of people that are all kind of coming together around not just solving a problem, but making like a really as enjoyable of an experience as you can. And hopefully the experience is completely unnoticed, but just contributes to a fun game,
yeah,
you know,
overall piece.
Exactly. Yeah.
So what is that process then, like working with the developers as you're making this music?
Yeah. Well, so there's a lot of different ways a composer can work with developers. A composer could be employed by a developer, and that's not something that happens very much in the United States, but in Japan and in other places, it's pretty common that a composer would be on staff at a development office,
mm-hmm,
and potentially being a composer that's one of many on a team that are all kind of contributing towards the product. Maybe that's under a manager or a music supervisor or somebody that's sort of kind of defining the entire sound.
Yeah.
But that manager that's defining the entire sound is kind of the outsourced composer idea. So that would be like the way American developers and European developers tend to work, especially if they want to work with film composers. Not every game, you know, big AAA games, AAA is the industry term for like the big, you know, games that have like a ton of visibility and, you know, are, I'm sure there's a certain amount of money
like
that
a
they're...
a blockbuster,
yeah,
kind of for
Hollywood,
video games.
Yeah. If you're trying to work with the Hollywood composing people, then very often, you know, this is the way you would have to do it. You would work with a single composer who themselves has a team of,
yeah,
people, and they're acting as the head composer and also the manager of the team of people that are kind of building the whole score. So there's a few different ways you can do it, and depending on where this game sits in the industry, they might want different types of things, and different ways of working with you, different ways of dealing with the rights of the music, mm-hmm. which is, you know, video games are a little different than, well, other areas of music are now kind of becoming more like video games,
yeah.
where video games for a while now have been on a kind of a buyout contract system. So the composer does not retain their rights to the music.
Just to work for hire.
Work for hire. And of course, you know, when you're an employee of a company, that makes sense that that would be, and then hopefully you have a profit share in the company and things like that.
Yeah.
So when you're doing, when you are outside the company and doing work for hire as a freelancer, you know, there's a few different ways that you can make that work. And oftentimes, especially for the bigger composers or bigger games, there'll be a per minute of approved music rate. So you get paid per minute of music that has been approved.
Oh, wow.
So, and there's, you know, so if you think of a game like Just Cause 4, there's 6 hours of music in the game. So, you know, there's, a lot of AAA games will have between 3 and up to well over 6 hours, especially
yeah.
like a big RPG or something like that. It would be many, many hours. So the per minute rate can work out if you get your music approved in a reasonable amount of revisions.
Yeah.
But if you get stuck in a revision cycle, that can be tough. But that's usually not that big of a problem as long as you are in a good relationship with the developers
yeah.
and everybody is like on the same page about what the goals are and everybody's paying attention to making sure that there's the right amount of, like that nobody, you're writing music that can be approved.
Yeah.
That's the other thing. Like we were talking about when you're in a part of the development cycle where the per minute rate would actually be able to work, because if you're too early, they could never...
What I was going to ask. Yeah. It seems like depending, because you don't necessarily have something to work off of, or you might have very little to work off of,
right.
does that become a big problem, or do you say, hey, I want to wait for more
yeah.
to be able to look at?
There's a few different things you could do there. You could do an approved minute thing and just know that this music is not approved for anything specific, so like mm-hmm. a theme or a suite or something like that, and it's like, this is approved as the sound of the game, not necessarily something that can be implemented in the game in the way that we've been talking about. Or you could be on a retainer and just be like, hey, we're gonna do some work for a while. And essentially the goal is maybe to come up with something, but it's not necessarily like a per minute thing. But yeah, that's part of the issues there.
Does it usually, like what system is usually put in place? Is it more of a work for hire thing? Is it a more approved per minute thing? Or is it kind of a grab bag of all of it?
Yeah, the work for hire and approved systems are sort of kind of operating together.
Okay.
So you're being hired, you are in a work for hire contract that is being measured by minutes of approved mm-hmm. music. So the way a lot of people would do it is video game developers are often working to milestones. So there's, you know, a developer might be working with their publisher to get certain parts of the game finished, certain milestones. So you can be working with the developer on these milestones and making sure that they have the music they need for the milestones. And then that's a good way of keeping up with them, make sure that you don't go too far past or that you don't fall behind where they are.
Yeah, just being in tandem.
And so you might have a master, you know, like bigger service agreement that's the kind of defines like a lot of the, like, you know, the actual buyout mechanisms and legal things like that. But then there's smaller contracts that go by these milestones to kind of keep things in the same pace.
How long is a typical contract with the developer? I imagine building such an immersive world is probably are you working on these things for like months at a time?
18 months or more.
Yeah, I was going to say.
Yeah, they take a long time. That's the other thing about games is that when you're writing a ton of music and you're part of this big process, they don't come out very regularly. And due to the nature of the business, becomes very difficult to talk about stuff that isn't out because they're covered by non-disclosure agreements. So I have a couple games that I would love to be talking about right
yeah.
now, extremely cool games, but unfortunately I can't talk about them yet. But one day very soon.
Well, actually that kind of brings up another question I had. What are those contracts like with those developers? Like how does that process work with you know, you licensing these things and putting those things together? Like what's the legal behind it?
Well, so there's a different kind of contract where you're doing a license.
Yeah.
So you can also, if it's a smaller game, they might not have the budget to pay a composer a per minute approved music rate. And in that case, you can keep your, potentially retain your ownership of the music and license it to the game. And you could do like an exclusive license for a certain amount of time. Mm-hmm. But you can do a step deal or something like that. So if the game sells this amount of copies, you know, you start seeing some sort of like higher, like a different license fee come in or something like that. There's a few different ways you could set that up and still retain ownership. But yeah, generally speaking, you know, the contracts are set up you have a large agreement that kind of defines, this is our relationship, like you're going to write music and we're going to buy the rights of the music out. And then there'll be, you agree to a per minute rate, which there is no industry standard. Unfortunately, there's no union, there's no any, you know, so there are people who could tell you what the general numbers are, but the numbers vary like extremely.
Because it's just such a new industry, kind of, there hasn't been a standard set?
I think it's just because there are so many, you know, you could hire me, you could hire Hans Zimmer, you could hire like all the people like in between, you know,
there's
people
who have,
I appreciate that, but you know, Hans Zimmer's pretty good. you know, so people have different numbers in mind. That's like, what does it take to put your team together? What does it take to, you know, to actually generate this music? What's the time frame? Do you need this entire game like in 6 months, or do you need it in 2 years? You know, mm-hmm. Like if I need to be working on this for 2 years, doesn't that change? Does that actually change my per minute rate to go higher, because it means I won't be able to do anything else essentially for 2 years? Or is my team big enough that I can do multiple things at the same time, and that might be able to help me keep the rate lower? You know, there's all these things that you have to factor in about what is your bottom line to do business. And what is the budget, obviously, and what kind of game are you working on, and stuff like that. So it's a tough part of the process, but the good news is that video games are not coming from a place of scarcity. The ceiling is going up. Video games,
every
especially
year.
During the pandemic, video games did really, really well. And there's jobs, there's work to be done, and people are willing to pay for quality work. So in that way, it's very different than other parts of the music industry, which always seem to feel like you're being shrinking. You always feel like the ceiling's getting lower and people are asking you to do more for less. And video games, I feel like, are in a different place.
Yeah.
That's a really cool thing.
I agree. And I know there's a lot of students here that are really interested in the New York, like video game compositions and stuff. We have a couple of students here. What is it like working in New York City?
Yeah.
And like in that world, and is there a lot of opportunities for people to kind of jump into that world here?
So New York is not a video game development hub. Mm-hmm. The video game development hubs like Seattle or Montreal, and then like in Texas actually there's a lot of video games. LA, of course, there's a ton of video games. For a number of different reasons, New York has not become a video game hub. But luckily that's changing, because there was a tax initiative incentive that was just put into place where they're trying to, similar to the film industry has a tax incentive,
yeah.
So trying to do something similar to that. The money was not even close to what it takes to fund a big AAA studio.
Yeah.
But what it means is that there's some smaller indie companies that might be taking advantage of it. And I think that's really good, because if there starts to be more of a community and a scene, I think that might attract more bigger companies that would hopefully go hand in hand with like a tax incentive that actually makes sense on the level for the biggest ones.
Yeah.
So right now there's two AAA studios, or maybe three now, I'm not sure, and a ton of indie studios and a bunch of people just making games for fun. And it's a good place to get involved, especially with the smaller games, because there's a ton of them being made. There's a group called Playcrafting that has a game, like a game, I don't even call it a showcase or a conference or something like that. Called. Mm-hmm. And you know, there's Game Jams, which is like you get together with your with like people you don't know or your friends and like make a game of kind of like a 48-hour film festival kind
That's
of thing.
That's fun. I love that.
These are good ways to like become
dive
more,
into it.
Yeah, more aware of the scene and stuff like that.
Yeah. I want to open it up to questions because I know we have a lot of people streaming. I know actually some people from my team wanted to ask questions. But if you had one piece of advice to, you know, some of the students that might be watching, what would you say is like a good way for somebody to start getting into, you know, the video game composition world would be?
I think it's to be very open, to be open to any type of musical experiences and open to any way of working with people, to think like very big and very forward about the way music can exist. Mm-hmm. And I think if you are developing skills to work with other people and to be part of a larger product and things like that, then you are already developing skills to do video games, even if, like me, you didn't know that that's what you were doing.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I hope everybody that wants to get into this world can find their path in just through kind of being open to new ideas and big ideas and things like that.
Evolving.
Yeah.
Exactly. I'd love to open it up for any questions, if we have any in the audience or in the chat. I knew Vin would have one.
Hello.
Okay, thanks.
So since you have already done some games, what is one that you'd want to redo? Not one that you've done, but a game out there that you think you can do the music better?
That is a crazy question.
That's a tough one.
I'm gonna give you a fake answer. So, did you play Ghost of Tsushima?
Yes, great game.
So Ghost of Tsushima is a great game with an incredible soundtrack. But the first time I heard that soundtrack, I was like unclear about what was going on. It's like this is a game about a very specific time and place in Japan, and I'm listening to a shakuhachi, but it doesn't sound correct. It doesn't sound like of the time and place that this is from. And I was like, I'm totally not into this at all. And then I was like, what is going on? Like, this is a Sony, why did Sony hire a non-Japanese company to develop this game about Japan when they themselves are Japanese companies? Like, this is all doesn't check out. And I was like, I'm totally not down with this music. And then at a certain point, I realized that they were going for this Hollywood lens. Like, you know, Sony's been thinking about transmedia, like what they did with The Last of Us TV show and the Uncharted movie. They've been thinking about how their intellectual property, their IP, can exist across so many different fields, right? And I think one thing they were thinking about with Ghost of Tsushima is we want to tell this epic story, and we want to tell it through the Hollywood lens. And once I realized that, which wasn't like some big, like, you know, I'm not like the world's smartest person for coming up with that, but it probably should have taken me a lot less time to realize that that was what they were doing. But once I did realize that, I was like, oh man, this is amazing, because this shakuhachi, these sounds are now kind of part of this lens, this fictional lens, this gloss that I'm now experiencing this game in a completely different way. And then it got really cool with me, because when you play that game, it's in a three-act structure, right? There's these two narrative bottlenecks, and they are physical bottlenecks on this island, the island of Tsushima. So as you cross them, the music changes really drastically. So it starts with this very pleasant but kind of like maybe inaccurate shakuhachi. Then you cross the first threshold, and all of a sudden the shakuhachi gets a little weird sounding. And then the third threshold, and you're up in the icy mountains and stuff, you know what I'm talking about? And
yeah.
Then the shakuhachi just becomes this like piercing, shrill air noise, and it's like incredibly harsh, and the game gets really difficult at that moment. Or not really difficult, it gets really difficult for me because I'm...
It got difficult for me too. Yeah.
But, you know, those moments of hearing how the music builds through, like becomes part of the world building of the game, those are like the really special moments for me. I feel like, generally speaking, I like a lot of video game music, and I feel like it's rare that I would hear a score that I feel like didn't do its game justice. And I think really, it's really sad when people talk about how much they don't like a score. It's often because they didn't like the game. And it's like, you know, like, I'm sorry, that there's nothing I can do about that, you know? So, yeah, that's my non-answer to your question. Sorry.
That's a good one.
Yeah. You got another one?
He's been waiting for this all week.
Yeah.
So kind of on music related, but what element added in video games do you think supplements the music most? Like, I personally think controller vibration like is a huge element to making a game feel more like impactful, like you said about music.
Yeah, I think you answered it. I think the controller is a great one, but I was gonna say lighting. I think like the lighting of a game is a hugely impactful. Actually, right now, working on something where the lighting hasn't been worked out for these, what is, I'm sure, going to be like a very happy, like bright, beautiful space. But right now, like, the lighting isn't in, so it's just like very creepy shadows everywhere and stuff like that. And, you know, the director's like, make sure you know that this isn't the actual, being very clear to me that the lighting wasn't finished yet, because it's so important to setting the mood. In terms of the actual physicality of, like, the intensity of something, yeah, I think control, like, haptic feedback is extremely cool. And I don't have a PS5 yet. I can't wait to get one. But it seems like what they did with the controller is pretty nuts. So it's
very cool.
Yeah, and I assume in VR and everything, it's like those kinds of experiences are going to be even more potent. So yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
One from Alex. There you go first.
Yeah, you got the mic.
So you mentioned at the beginning someone reached out to you if you wanted to try out video game scoring.
Yeah.
How would you have approached that from, I guess, like, to restart, but from an outsider point, like, where would you go to start getting spots?
Yeah. So that was a unique situation. And again, like, I don't know if I would have come to this talk prior to have becoming a video game composer, because it wasn't on my radar. But if it was on my radar, I would have done a lot of different things and would have tried to meet a lot of people. So the people who can hire you as a video game composer are, generally speaking, audio directors. And audio directors, you know, they know people. They might outsource to a talent agent. They might say, hey, agent, I'm looking for a composer for my game. Can you recommend some people? But they might just know you. So I think the best thing to do is to know people in the game industry, which is difficult to do in New York City. As we talked about, there's not as much of it here. But the cool thing about the game industry is that everybody is really, really nice. And everybody goes to these networking events because everybody recognizes this is the best way to get to know people. So going to video game networking events and meeting people, and not trying to network necessarily, like, network. I think everyone here already has heard somebody saying that, like, if you try to do that, it's gonna not help, you know what I mean? But the game industry people are friendly people and they wanna be friends. And so it works really nice to go be friends with people at these networking events. And I think a lot of good can come from that. And there's a lot of support amongst people. There's like a lot of Discord groups, there's game audio meetups, there's things like that. There's a game audio meetup in New York that has sadly been defunct for a little while that we're hoping to start up again soon. So I will post about that on my social medias whenever that happens. But yeah, I would say that's the number one thing to do. And, you know, if you do these game jams and things like that, you can develop a reel of work that kind of showcases your sound and your ability to work on interactive stuff. And, you know, those are important things. But I think the most important thing people look for in a composer is just somebody that, you know, is providing a good product, like, they're providing good music that's good, like, you know, not to discount that, but they're also delivering on time and, you know, showing up when they're supposed to show up and, you know, being communicative and like that. I think that's true probably of any industry, not just composing. Did they answer your question? I'm sorry, I feel like I went off topic. Yeah. Okay. Cool. Yep.
Hi, Zach.
Hi.
I have two questions. First question is, how much input do you have in, like, the mix down? If it's where your composition or even the sound design is in the stereo field?
I have, I would say I have I am in communication about where the music is in the mix and the stereo field from the very beginning of the process. But I certainly am not, so video game mixing is different than other types of mixing because you're not mixing start to finish an experience, you're mixing these different scenarios of things that could possibly happen. It's not like the same as mixing a film or mixing a piece of music or something like that. But I'm extremely aware of the frequency range of the sound design and where it sits in the stereo field and where the music needs to sit so that you can bring the music up against the sound design or the dialogue and know that it's going to sit there across multiple scenarios. So, you know, interestingly, in a game like Second Extinction, the gun noise is essentially like, and I love the way this game is mixed, but the audio director, who is also the mixer, like essentially just scooped out and ducked the music when the guns happen, and then the music comes back up really loud when they're not playing. So there's like a dynamic compression happening that makes the game feel really intense and unnatural kind of way of mixing, but it works really, really well in that situation. So I knew that with these gun noises being like such a big deal, and knowing that they put so much time into making sure that these gun noises were going to sound good and be like a cathartic experience for the player, knowing that, okay, what is the fundamental frequency of these guns? And I definitely don't want to write any music that has that frequency in the center that needs to be heard over a gun, because there's no way, you know what I mean? The gun is going to take precedent. So I knew I had a playthrough video. We were actually touching on this earlier, and I'm sorry I didn't finish my thought about this, but while I can't play the game necessarily at the beginning of the process, I will have like a video of a playthrough with the sound design in. And I'm looking at EQs, and I'm looking at the stereo image or more, the multi-channel image or something like that, and seeing where it's all sitting, and then designing the music around that. So a game like Second Extinction would be very different than a game where, you know, a quiet game, like a puzzle game or a game like that doesn't have very much like that going on. And you have to be acutely aware of that as a composer, or else you're gonna be causing people a lot of trouble down the road. So did I answer question number one? Cool.
Question number two, what can people that's beginning or even intermediary doing this, what can they do to practice in their home studio to do something like what you're doing?
That's a good question. I think to practice, you could rescore a game. That would be really fun, actually. I never thought about that. And this would help if you happen to dislike the score of a game that you can, in pretty much any game, you can turn off the music. So you could rescore your own game, and if you wanted to get nuts, you could set up like Wise or audio middleware to run your new score along with the game, and they couldn't, I mean, you couldn't get them to actually talk to each other. You could set up some sort of like second controller so that you, okay, now I'm entering combat, like, okay, hit the combat music, and now I'm entering exploration, okay, hit the exploration music, and try to like sync it up as best as you can to see how it would work. I think that might be even something people do in, oh, Here's a much better way to do that. Sorry. So Wise, WISE, they are very good about education for people learning how to use a very complicated and kind of not, it's like a hard, the learning curve is steep. They have tutorial games. There's one called the Wise Adventure Game, which it's just like a very simple action RPG game that you can download for free. You can download Wise for free, and you can design your own music system for it and just try it out. And they have another one called Cube, which I think is used for that as well. So these games are free to download. Wise is free to download also, as is FMod. They're not free to use. So if you're developing a game and you're expecting to sell a certain amount of copies of the game, you need to pay a license to use that technology in your game. But to actually download it and to use it as a human is free. So I would highly recommend, if anybody wanted to practice, to do either rescore your own game or use one of one of the tutorial games that Wise makes, and I'm sure FMOD has some too, that you can get in there and just put in your own music and try it out. Or you can attend the NYU Video Game Scoring Workshop next week, where that's actually what you do in the workshop. Or you can go to NYU and take Ronnie's class, which is what you do in the class. So, yeah.
Any other questions?
I have a question about tempo in the chat. In open world games, do you tend to have music be the same BPM so the transitions are smooth? Also, how does the transition logic work? Do you set up rules to trigger transitions on tempo?
So in Just Cause 4, there are moments of silence between exploration and combat, which is good because A, having it go directly from one to the other doesn't seem to really work very well in terms of the dramatic nature of that. But B, it allows the segues to work a little better. You could create tempo syncs and create transition sections that go from a piece of exploration music to a piece of combat music, and all the audio middleware software allows you to do something like that. So you would have to write a transition per piece to each piece, so that could be a lot. If you have in Just Cause 4, that would have been hundreds of transitions, I would say. So doable, but maybe not the best use of time, especially when silence was working so well to go from one to the other. The thing that we did do, which I think worked really well, was we have harmonic relationships between different sections of the music. So the exploration music is generally in like no flats or sharps, generally like A minor-ish, and the music for combat is generally D minor-ish. So just like super basic music theory, right, that's a 5-to-1. So you're kind of cadencing from exploration to combat. And even if that music doesn't align directly, it's not so much silence in between them that you wouldn't maybe hear that there has been a tonal shift. And that tonal shift is something that's not so far out of left field that it feels like you're in a completely different experience. You're in something that's kind of, you're logically moving on to the next section of the game. So I feel like that tonal shift did a good job creating the transitions, even if we didn't have a direct segment from one to the other. Did I get that whole question? I felt like there was more parts of it.
Yeah,
it?
Thank you.
Yeah.
Anything else from the chat?
That was it in the chat.
Cool. Do you have any last wrapping thoughts you want to drop on everybody?
Well, just generally thank everybody here and everybody online for attending this and listening to me talk. There's so much amazing stuff going on in the world of video game music, and I'm so happy that y'all are interested in it, and I look forward to hearing some of your music one day, and thanks so much for listening.
Let's all give it up for Zach.
Yeah. Thanks, man.